Welcome back to session three. My name is Brendan Taylor. I'll be the chair of today's session, which is looking at opportunities to deepen the Australia-Japan-US strategic partnership. I'd just like to begin by thanking Rory Metcalfe and colleagues at the NSC for the opportunity to be part of this panel today. We've got three really great speakers lined up, each of whom will speak to you for about 10 or 15 minutes each, starting off with Colonel Grant Newsham, who's a senior research fellow at the Japan Forum for Strategic Studies. Then an old friend and colleague, Dr. Ross Babbage, a non-resident senior fellow at the Centre for Strategic and Budgetary Assessments. For those of you who haven't caught it yet, Ross has just put out a very good and important paper on the South China Sea that I'd certainly recommend to you. And last but certainly not least, we'll hear from Professor Yuichi Hosoya from Keio University. We'll hopefully have some time for Q&A at the end of the session, so without further ado, could you please warmly welcome Colonel Newsham to the floor.
Thank you, I'm glad to be here. One of the earlier speakers this morning mentioned something like the facade of a Marine officer, with the implication it was like expecting a moron. So I'll see if I can live up to that. Okay, now obviously what I'm talking about is real concrete opportunities for trilateral cooperation between the Americans, the Japanese, and the Australians, actually in the reverse order. And when I was in Sydney for a day before I got here. So I got up early in the morning and I went out to get pavlova for breakfast. And I ascertained that this is not the custom. So I kept going around the harbor by the Opera House and then went round again by the Botanic Gardens. And then I came around a corner and behold, there was an amphibious ship. And then there was even another amphibious ship. And then in the middle, there was an old amphibious ship. Now this almost made up for the absence of pavlova. Because I like amphibious ships. I like amphibious things for some reasons I'll get to. The submarine deal that failed, I'll just mention this very quickly. I think that's a blessing in disguise. I can imagine what would have happened once MHI had to deal with Australian labor unions. It could be that the Japanese and the Australians ended up hating each other. It's gone away. But that said, there's the opportunity to deepen Japan and Australian defense relationships with the knock-on psychological and political effects is offered by these ships, by this thing. I saw it again later once the sun had really come up. These amphibious ships, the amphibious capability and the development of this gives you an opportunity to really deepen the relationship in some meaningful ways. And obviously Japan has got a smallish amphibious capability that's getting a bit better, but it's certainly serviceable. Australia is a bit ahead. And will have a battalion, basically has a battalion size capability either now or really soon. And there's something qualitatively different about amphibious training, about merging amphibious capabilities. I would compare it to CrossFit training, where you have to exercise air, sea, and ground capabilities together. It's exponentially more difficult than, say, sending a platoon of GSDF, Japanese Army, to Talisman Sabre, which is, it's better than nothing, but not by much. But compared to amphibious, if you could join the amphibious units or capabilities together, then you're getting some, say, the CrossFit training. Otherwise, it's kind of like lifting up a little weight with your right arm, and you have no idea what your other arms are going to do. But the CrossFit, you do an amphibious exercise, get together, figure it out, and do it, you suddenly had to build every muscle in the body. And that's how you get better. There's a couple things that amphibious capability does. It forces jointness. It forces the Army, Navy, and Air Force to cooperate. Otherwise, you can't do that kind of operation. And that is a shortcoming in every military, everywhere. Additionally, it forces sort of external jointness, where when you get together with a foreign country's amphibious force, and try and figure it out, you have suddenly done something much more complicated and deeper than just the rudimentary, almost pro forma exercises that take place in parallel, ended up with a barbecue where everyone declares everything is fine. Also, what you get out of an amphibious, working together amphibiously, is you develop a useful operational capability. you can actually, then you suddenly have the ability to take men and equipment from ship to shore and back again. And until you have that an amphibious capability, you can't do it in any useful way. And this capability is immediately useful, and particularly in HADR, humanitarian assistance, disaster relief operations. So you saw the Australians just last year had with their new amphib force, they sent it over to Fiji after a storm, did very well. The Japanese in 2013, towards the end, they sent basically three ships down to the Philippines after the big hurricane and did pretty well. And that was based on their rudimentary amphibious capability that they had put together about 4 months before that. It's worth noting that after the tsunami in 2011, because Japan had no capability, they let about 3,000 to 4,000 people freeze to death in the first 24, 48 hours because they did not have the ability to do amphibious operations. So there's a real practical usefulness to it. Also, I would note that 90% of the things, of the know-how, the hardware that you have to, in order to do an amphibious operation is identical to what you use for war fighting. It's 90% the same at least. The only difference is you're not hitting the launch switch and trying to kill people. But more often than not, you're doing HADR operations. Now, additionally, and I'd mentioned it earlier, there's a psychological effect of doing this kind of sophisticated military-to-military training. And it's a political effect, psychological effect. Force builds up its confidence. It builds up its confidence in familiarity with its counterparts. And this has a way of translating into, say, in things beyond the military, the military realm. And as I said, amphibious training is infinitely better than, say, the pro forma feel-good sort of operation training and exercises, which many people are very happy with. Now, how do you bring this about? Now, I'll start with the Japanese and the Australians. Because that's really what we need, in my opinion, is to have the Japanese and the Australians get together and actually do something. And put simply, do an amphibious operation, an exercise, either in Australia, up in Japan, do it in Guam. Start small. Even just a couple ships is fine. Maybe give it an HADR focus. But you have to go through the planning required. You have to do the cross-decking where you can put Japanese on Australian ships and Australians on Japanese ships. You can fly your aircraft helicopters from one ship to another, and you're really exercising all the body parts. And the objective is to be able to operate well enough together to do a real-world operation. And that's, compared to most exercises, that is a fairly tall order, but that's the objective. Let's say start small, and start with the Australians and the Japanese. You have the hardware. Go ahead and do it. Now, where does the Americans fit into this? U.S. involvement would be nice, but I would suggest it's not essential. It would be good to have American Navy and Marine advisors in on this, and maybe perhaps an American ship might join in. But as I said, it's important that the Japanese and the Australians take the lead on this. Historically, it's been the Americans who, like the Harlem Globetrotters, go around the region and have these amphibious exercises, and they show how terrific they are. And they might let somebody from the audience come in and they hold them up and let them drop the ball through the hoop, and they go away. And they've established kind of a cargo cult of amphibiosity. And if the Americans aren't there, nobody seems to get any better. But what you need is the other people in the regions to do things together, plus the significance of Japan and Australia doing this kind of sophisticated training. It has once again, a political effect, and that's worth doing. But going off on a small tangent, what you can do immediately, both the Australians and the Japanese, is take advantage of an American MEU-ARG, the Amphibious Ready Group Marine Expeditionary Unit, like the 31st MEU. And these go all around, and there's no reason you cannot plug and play, why you cannot put an Australian ship into this and a Japanese ship into this. And this could be done any time that the desire is there. And just doing that alone would have immense significance. It'd be operationally useful. Additionally, you'd learn a lot, and once again, there is a real significance to this sort of thing. Now, looking out, now sort of back on track now, looking out a few years, if the Australians and the Japanese can make some progress with the amphibious angle, then invite in a few select countries to maybe join in, perhaps Singapore, Indonesia, Vietnam, but don't invite everybody at once. And then gradually, maybe what I would suggest is go aim for something like an amphibious rim pack. You have in Hawaii this rim pack exercise, which is a very exclusive party to which everybody in the neighborhood is invited. And they do some of everything, so they end up not doing some of the things they should be doing. But an amphibious rim pack, say sponsored by the Japanese and New Zealand, is something to aim for. Additionally, once you can, if you can make some progress here, why not the possibility of using amphibious capability, particularly for HADR operations, to try and get, use that as the thing around which a sort of regional force could coalesce. The idea has been raised before, but it just takes some imagination. Now, the key to a lot of this, if you want to make progress, and this is based on my experience, and is that if you need to have liaison officers. The Australians send them up to the GSDF and the MSDF. The Japanese send them to the Australians. If you don't have them, this simply becomes something like a once-a-year convention which everyone goes to, has fun, and goes away. But a liaison officer there who is not there to answer the mail and have a neat time, but rather to further amphibious capabilities and linking these things. That's what you need. I've had senior Marine officers tell me that we have 16, and I've suggested having American LNOs put around the region, that we have 16,000 active duty Marine officers, we have twice as many reserve ones, but we don't have a single one available for liaison officer work. Nor do we have 5 cents. So anyway, that's one of the challenges you will face. So if you can do the, once again, you can see what I think of amphibious capability and its usefulness for actually doing something concrete for the particularly Japan-Australia relationship, both defense and political relationship, but the Americans can get worked into this anytime very easily, but they should not, ideally not take the lead, but support it in every way possible. If you do that, you've done something good, plus nobody will even remember the submarine deal. Now, the last thing I want to go over, because you know, I think everyone probably agrees with what I've said, in principle at least. You will find that there's any number of senior officers who can give you 10 reasons why a good idea is a bad one. And I'll go over these ideas, and I've heard every one of these from Americans and Japanese collectively. But I just want to inoculate you. We have no money, we have no ships, we have no fuel, we don't have any officers available. It's too far away to go do it. We've never done it before. We already have the capability since we have an amphibious ship. We did an exercise once. Why do we need to do another one? We sent a platoon to Talisman Sabre. We have an amphibious capability. It's too hard. We're too busy. We're busy in the Middle East. That's a good one. That works perfectly, particularly for the Marines. And the Chinese will complain. Now, if you drill down on all of these, just keep asking, and what you come up with, the real reason is, well, we don't feel like it. Well, you should feel like it. But anyway, that is, and I want to leave you with something. This is it. The one thing to remember is the potential benefit, usefulness of amphibious capability, and this amphibious rim pack held down in Australia or somewhere, in Guam or somewhere, figure it out. That's the thing that you should keep in mind, and that's sort of the objective. It's a few moves out, but if you remember nothing, when you hear about trilateral, bilateral cooperation, amphibious capability development is an excellent way to do it. And this amphibious rim pack, if that's your end state, that'd be pretty good as well. So, and what I'll end with is, I was here a few years ago, and I was in Hunter Valley to speak at a thing. And I really wanted pavlova, because I like the stuff. And I went in, I looked everywhere. I had the hotel concierge try to track some down. And he was unsuccessful. So I even went to a bakery in this little place. And I said, you have pavlova? And the lady says, why don't you ask your grandmother to make it? And I still haven't found any. But anyway, well, thank you very much.
Let me say it's a special pleasure to be back here at ANU amongst friends and colleagues and addressing really a pretty important topic. My aim this afternoon is to be very brief and very clipped and really to throw out some points for consideration and hopefully a bit of discussion. I really want to build on some of the broader points, very excellent points that were made by a range of folks this morning. I don't want to try and repeat them. But what I'm going to focus on, a bit like the way Grant has, is some of the practical issues. What are some of the practical things we could seriously consider doing to build, if you like, more meat on the bones, more muscle, if you like, to some extent, on the bones of this these trilateral relationships we have? Okay, I'm not going to address this at all, really, except to say this is my top 10 for those. Why should we bother? And there are occasionally people who say that, not many actually, I'm glad to say. There are many other reasons why we should be doing this, but they're just some of the points that I've got up there. And so I'm going to just touch quickly on 12 options issues. And my first one is this. We don't really have a strategy. We don't have a strategy for how we should be managing China. And for that matter, we don't really have a very well-developed strategy for handling North Korea and some of the broader security issues. So my first question is this. What is the outcome we want? If you're going to have a strategy, you better work out where we're going or where we want to go. Are we clear what we want the region to look like in 5 years' time or in 10 years' time or perhaps further down the field? If we can define that, and I suggest we should be doing this together, then I think it's possible to start considering a range of options for strategy. Now, in Washington, there are a range of options being tossed around by various people. This is just four of them. I'm not going to dwell on them. Denial strategy. Denial strategy is not just a physical denial. This is actually to deny an opponent or a competitor the political, economic, social, whatever they may be, advantages that they may think they're winning by acting over-assertively, aggressively, in a destabilizing way. Cost imposition, pretty obvious. Make it expensive for them, in not just economically, in a whole raft of other ways. Thirdly, understand the other guy's strategy and undermine it. And the last one is, well, if you think of strategy as the context, if you're going to get what you really need, you need the other side to change, the leadership on the other side to change their mind. How do you pressure the leadership on the other side to change their mind? How do you do it? And in some of the work that's been done recently in the South China Sea, it's been very interesting because most people we've spoken to in the early research stage immediately said, well, there's only three or four options we've got. And almost everyone's highlighted then diplomatic and military options. The conclusion after consideration in closed workshops with some very senior people was actually some of the most powerful and effective options were neither diplomatic in a formal sense or military. I'm not saying they're irrelevant, but they did include elements of all those. So what we're talking about here, depending upon what your strategy is selectively taking a range of instruments, and there are many, many more measures than most people will have thought about yet, and putting them together in various ways to have the effect you really want on getting change. And for those who are interested in this whole strategy development process, you may want to have a look at this. Brendan mentioned earlier, it's a very recent report we've put out on the strategy options in the South China Sea, and it's available free on the CSBA website and also on the Strategic Forum website. The second thing I think, and I'm going to now accelerate, the second thing we really got to do is, it seems to me, the mechanisms we've got at the moment for trilateral consultation, they're friendly, they're good in some respects, but they're pretty ad hoc, most of them. And it's I think it's time we thought more creatively about what we should be having, both at senior government level, but I think also at the operational level and at the tactical level. We need to have better links. Maybe the sort of proposal on amphibious operations is, could be one element of doing that. I think another thing, when we think about, just for a second, about the Australia-Japan element of the relationship, there's one thing that I think is grossly underdeveloped. If those of us have been involved, much of our careers in Australia anyway, dealing with the United States, there is a whole incredibly complex and sophisticated network of friendships, partnerships, business relationships, all sorts of things. Most of us know a lot of Americans, many of them are in senior positions, some of us know General Mattis and other people like that. And so the way we understand each other really has a, you know, it seriously reflects that level of personal intimacy you've got with lots of different people. I'd suggest to you, we have, for Australians, most Australians, including the official community, that our networks in Japan are much less developed. And I think we ought to be doing more about that. And I think we ought to be thinking about how to do that. Part of it is to train more together, including in staff colleges and similar ways. I think we also, in our trilateral work, we ought to be looking beyond the three of us to other things we ought to be doing together with other regional partners and friends. And one of the big themes that I believe in very strongly is we ought to be working very closely, especially with the countries in maritime Southeast Asia, but there are others, not least in, I certainly would include India in this, in looking at with them and talking with them in offline, private discussions about what the security challenges, how they see their security challenges, and asking them what we can do to give them a hand. The idea is really, if Australia, the United States and Japan did similar things together and worked with some of these regional neighbours and friends in a true partnership way to help them build their resilience against, particularly against external coercion, that would be a great advantage for them and for us. There's a lot of work, of course, that's happened in the last few years about regional C4ISR, in particular, making what I'm talking about here is making most of Southeast Asia effectively transparent. And making, my thinking on this was some years ago was that, well, you know, maybe we can have a secret version of what's really happening in the maritime sphere and share that with our relevant ASEAN friends. And there's, I think, you know, that was sort of fairly readily agreed by many. What has surprised me is that many of my American colleagues believe it's possible to do pretty well what we're talking about here in an unclassified forum. The point I'm making here is I'm not going to sort of speak about what the Japanese public opinion is or might be or perception of what's been going on, particularly in the South China Sea, and what's been going on in terms of the island building and the, now we have effectively just being finished now, three air bases on three of the islands in the Spratlys. I think the Australian knowledge of that is really weak. But it wouldn't be really weak if we actually were telling the public and showing them the photography and showing them other things. It's obvious. The before and after pictures are riveting. And when I've occasionally briefed business groups in this country, they're shocked, but then they're angry. Why weren't we told? And I think it's a fair point. And I think it's a point about political leadership. We need to get better at it. And making the region more transparent, I think I see as being a very appropriate thing for democracies to do. Another option to consider is think about the problems the United States has, and I'm not a pessimist in one respect. I think the United States is, and I think this Trump administration is dead serious about building and strengthening, rebuilding, if you like, US military capability. It'll take time, but there's a lot of things that are going to be coming down the pike. And I think we're also going to see more deployed forward over time. The problem with that for the Americans is that it's all very well to deploy more forces forward, and already they've done some of that, but they don't really have the exercise and range facilities to maintain currency and readiness levels in the forward theatre to the level that they really need. Well, Japan has not a similar problem in some senses because of its geographic constraints. There are many things it has trouble with doing in exercise activities, but Australia has a competitive advantage. We've got a lot of space. Got a lot of good exercise areas. We could actually make these, we actually could network them in new ways, although there is some pretty advanced instrumentation on most of these range facilities already, and make those things a more a valuable thing for all three parties and for our other partners in the region. it would potentially over time build a lot of good relationships and do other things besides. I think we're getting close to needing a strategic planning group between the three of us of some shape or form to plan and think about, talk about the sort of contingencies we may face and think about how we're going to handle them if they arise. I think there is scope for expanded intelligence cooperation for a range of reasons. We're developing, of course, and we're acquiring many of the same technologies and systems. At the moment, the point I'd really like to stress here is I think at the tactical and local area in particular, it's really important that we have better mechanisms for exchanging intelligence and operational information. The last thing we want to do is be bumping into each other unexpectedly, and we need to be working in a more coordinated fashion. I think, there's been several mentions of this morning, of course there have been significant developments with the United States and Japan about developing access agreements in recent months and years. But I think there's scope for going quite a bit further, and I think we're going to need it. And we ought to be thinking creatively about how to best progress these agendas to make it easy for the three countries to work in and around our own theatres, our own operating areas. I think there's scope also for considering how we can do a range of things in the cyber domain together. There's a lot going on in some parts of this, but I also think there's scope for helping our regional neighbours build their defensive capabilities. There's some work going on there too, but I think it's worth having a discussion about. One thing that I think we'd all agree on is we're seeing ballistic missile, and for that matter cruise missile, but particularly domestic missiles, proliferating substantially right across the region. And of course we've seen Japan deploy, and now South Korea receiving from the United States THAAD and other capabilities. And of course we have a number of naval combatants in Japan, and obviously the US West in the 7th Fleet with capacities to operate in various forms of ballistic missile defence modes. All of those are expensive, but there are new things coming. And what it might surprise some of you to know is that all three parties, in my view, have some things to bring to the table. Australia actually has some very advanced technology which is not generally known in some elements of this, which are likely to be pertinent. And my last point is this. I think there's scope for some joint defence development and production programs between the three countries. I think there, in particular, it's interesting to contemplate between Australia and Japan, and this is another way of thinking beyond the submarine, but there are some things underwater that are not necessarily the major boats themselves that could easily be done and potentially, with great advantage, be done together. Japan has a lot of expertise, so does Australia in certain areas. And there's a range of other areas as well. I think it's really worth thinking more creatively and considering how that can be done. So that's a quick dance through of my top 12. It seems to me my conclusions are fourfold. There are many more reasons than ever that we ought to be doing more together. There are many opportunities and options. It seems to me we'll only get where we want to go if we know where we're going, and we really need to have a joint strategy. And we need to step beyond the priorities of the past, because what we're looking at now is a rather different regional environment, and we're going to have to do different things, and preferably together more, and we're going to have to get energetic about it. Thank you.
Thank you very much for giving me the second opportunity to talk today, because this is my second chance. In this morning I talked a lot, so my talk should be brief to leave sufficient time for discussion, further discussion with you all. Well, in the morning I was quite pessimistic about the future of regional security challenges, but I am more optimistic about the trilateral security cooperation for some reasons. I will talk why. In the beginning, I like to talk why it is necessary, because three countries, United States, Australia, and Japan are the leading maritime nations in this area. And also these three countries are leading democracies in this region. From the point of view of value and norms, and from the point of view of the nature of these countries' powers, I think that it is really important for the three countries to deepen and broaden security cooperation, particularly for the purpose of maintaining open and stable seas. Open and stable seas is a core concept of Japan's national security strategy, which was published in December 2013. And since then, Japanese security strategy or policy has been focusing on the importance of maintaining open and stable seas. And for that reason, I think that Japanese government has been critical to what China has been doing in South China Sea. So to maintain open and stable seas, Japanese partners, when we think about partners, of course, no doubt, two countries, United States and Australia, are the most important partners for Japan to do that. So this is why. The second thing is how we can do it. We can deepen and broaden security cooperation among the three maritime powers. There are several different levels. The first level is operational level. I think that from the operational point of view, the three countries have already deepened, to some extent, security cooperation, defense cooperation. But there are other levels. The next level is a strategic level, and it is already mentioned. And maybe strategic coordination would be the most important, perhaps, area where three countries can do because of their difference about the understanding about the nature of Chinese power. Three powers basically, I think, welcome the economic growth of China. But from the geographical differences, I think that their conception about Chinese military power is quite different. That's why I think 2 years before 2015, April 2015, Feng, two governments, Japanese government and United States government, agree on the new guidelines for the US-Japan defense cooperation. Feng, it was published until then. Two governments needed to really talk a lot about the fulfilling that gap between their understanding of China. And so I think that the strategic coordination is very difficult, but at the same time, furthermore, strategic differences on the understanding about the nature of Chinese military power is one of the most difficult points that three governments should talk more. This is an important issue, I agree. I really think that three governments really need to talk deeply and negotiate deeply about fulfilling the gap on that point. So this is a strategic level. The other level is policy planning. I think that on that point, United States often produce new strategic concept. And then I think the Japanese government tried to incorporate that new strategic concept into Japanese defense policy, like AT-AD or air-sea battle and anti-AT-AD operation, and also air-sea battle concept and so on. That's why in 2010 and in 2013, when Japanese government created new Japanese guideline for national defense, they introduced a new concept of dynamic defense force. And by introducing this new dynamic defense force, Japanese government can focus on both maritime self-defense forces and air self-defense forces to try to adapt to new American security concept. So this kind of level of cooperation is also very important. But I think that the fourth level will become, to some extent, the most probable and perhaps important. The fourth level is cooperation on the development of new defense equipment, because the Trump administration is very much interested in doing it together with Japan or other countries. In the beginning of this month, I visited Washington, D.C., several conservative think tanks, and I talked with some people who are close to Trump team. And they, not most of them, but some of them focus on the importance of U.S.-Japan cooperation on defense development, because this can produce, of course, American jobs. And also, this can produce stronger American defense. And Japan should serve it. Of course, it will be difficult for Japan to do it from a Japanese national interest point of view. we can deepen our defense cooperation, but maybe Japanese government and, of course, Japanese some business companies need to really think about what kind of way Japan can collaborate with the United States on that issue. But anyway, of course, this can serve to strengthen trilateral security cooperation. But there are different levels of cooperation. And in the beginning, maybe Japanese government and the Australian government need to understand what kind of level of cooperation the new US administration is really interested in. By understanding it, because it's not still clear, so we need to clearer understanding about American new administration's interest in deepening security cooperation. It depends on that. And of course, a new administration shows no willingness to deny any kind of security cooperation. Of course, in some areas of security defense cooperation, I'm sure that the new administration under President Trump is interested in, but it's not still clear. So we need to have a clear understanding. Then, finally, I like to focus on Japanese approach to the security cooperation with these two countries, among the three countries, three maritime powers. One of the biggest change which we saw, of course, is security bills. Until then, the Japanese security cooperation with other partners or ally was extremely limited to just like a humanitarian assistance or disaster relief. Maybe that's all. Because if it's quite unnatural and strange, well, if Japan joining some a computer simulation with the United States, Australia to do some joint exercise, some areas of this joint exercise could be regarded as constitutionally illegal, unconstitutional, because it, according to cabinet legislation bureau, it relates to the exercise of the collective self-defense. So Japan could not do this kind, could not join in some areas of joint exercise with the United States or with Australian forces. So after the passing of the security bill, the government has cleared so many limits in deepening security cooperation. And the biggest focus of the security bill is to broaden security cooperation in the areas of first, PKO, and the second, logistical support. So Japan, from now on, Japan can much deeply do it, of course, together with the United States, or together with Australian government, or together with other forces. So this is a big change. So we now have much larger area of security cooperation, which we could not have before the security legislation. But our focus is not combating operations. Non-combating operation is our focus. Logistical support and also PKO, and particularly peacetime security cooperation is our main focus of security cooperation. So in the peacetime, there are so many things that we can do, like joint exercise, as I talked, because there were so many limits in doing it, as some of the military people fully understand, perhaps. So this kind of security cooperation in the peacetime is our focus, and also PKO is another focus. So there are some new areas that Japanese self-defense forces can do together with other forces. And based upon Japan's national security strategy, this should serve to maintain or create regional stability, because it is written in Japan's national security strategy document that our first priority of national security strategy is to maintain rule-based international order. And I'm sure that the Australian government can fully share this point of view. And I'm also sure that the US administration can step by step fully understand the importance of maintaining rule-based international order. So there are many areas, and there are many possibilities and new frontiers, but we need to focus on some areas. We need to have some priorities, because we cannot do everything. And this kind of peacetime security cooperation in the peacetime and PKO logistical support and this kind of thing is, of course, I think Japan's focus. And from these areas on, I think that Japan can broaden security cooperation with particularly Australia and the United States. And finally, I'd like to say that it is usually thought that or seen that Japan is a follower, and America is a leader. Largely, of course, it's true. But in some areas, it's not true. Like a new guideline for defense cooperation between Japan and the United States. This was initiated by Japan. In the beginning, US government didn't think that it is important or it is necessary. Of course, it is important. But at the same time, United States government thought that it could use previous defense guidelines because Japan did not fully fulfill its requirements. But Japanese government thought it was necessary and it is important because of the new security environment in East Asia. And the person who actually launched the process was defense at the time, defense minister Morimoto. He, as defense minister, initiated the process and Prime Minister Abe actually succeeded in realizing it. So it was a necessary process and Japan initiated it. And once again, I think that Japan and Australia, by coordinating fully, two government can lead in some areas of trilateral security cooperation to create, to make trilateral security cooperation more constructive and more acceptable to other regional powers. Thank you very much.
Well, what we might do is to start off with a round of questions and comments from the floor and then give the panel a chance to respond to those. If you could just identify yourself as you ask those your questions or make your comments, that would be much appreciated. So start off with Professor Kirsten.
Hello, Ricky Kirsten from Murdoch University. I'd like to ask Professor Hosoya, if the US were to step back from its primary role in maintaining order and stability, to what extent do you think Japan wants to or is willing to or is capable of filling a leadership gap in maintaining the liberal international system?
Thanks. There's a question up there, gentleman up the back.
My name is Mitchell Smith. I'm from the Department of Immigration and Border Protection. I noticed that you, all three of you, sort of focus more on the military side of cooperation. I wonder if you believe that civil maritime cooperation, such as through Coast Guards or, in our case, Coast Guards equivalent, is an effective way to further the trilateral relationship?
Hi, a lot of great ideas. My compliments to the thinkers up there for putting those together. A lot of this is what we call in America motherhood and apple pie. There's nothing that was said that anybody could argue against and would be received in all three countries, I think. How do we get this thing started?
Okay, well, just address a couple of those. The first, the civil maritime cooperation. It's a good idea. If you look at the size of the US Coast Guard, you could probably fit the whole thing into this room. One of my take is it's just too small to make a huge difference. Although that said, we're one example of where there is a sort of a good opportunity for some bilateral cooperation would be to actually sort of cut, you know, bring a U.S. Coast Guard cutter, two of them maybe, to Japan, and have them do joint patrols down in the East China Sea around the Senkakus with the U.S. Navy in the background. That is standing up on one's hind legs and biting back a bit. But that's one example of how it might be done. If you need more ships, build more. There's opportunities there. But I see in terms of scale and actually the oomph, that it's the military that is probably where the biggest opportunities are. Though say not to overlook the civil cooperation. The question about what Japan could do, I'll leave that up to a real Japanese person. And the question about how does it get going? I'm convinced that if you leave it up to the captains and the majors, you'll make progress. And I'm not entirely joking. It has to be the top dogs have to say, this is what we want, and then give it to some aggressive major on all sides and have them get it done. I would note the Australian LNO to Marfor PAC most recently, a fellow named Pat Davidson, was a major and was basically responsible for a very good amphibious portion of the RIMPAC exercise. And it was really through his efforts that it was done. Another option, and this is last one, is an anecdotal thing, is that Japan's amphibious capability, they had none at the time of the tsunami, and then 18 months later, they were able to send 3 ships across the ocean to California to do something like an amphibious exercise. You had people on the Japanese side who knew that this was necessary. And the Americans finally put a Marine in Tokyo with implied orders to do something useful and don't ask permission. And you're able to get this done in an ad hoc way and actually move things forward pretty well. So it's kind of a screwy way that happened. But ultimately, if the top people on both sides decide it's necessary, just say, this is what we want, and then leave it up to the working class to get it done, I think you can make progress. But somebody's got to say, this is what we want.
Can I start with, the really interesting question about, well, why do we focus primarily on the military when, we've got civil maritime cooperation and implied, I think in the question, and I hope you implied, actually there's a whole lot of other things as well. And I think you're absolutely right. I think a few quick observations. I think part of the issue is that what we have in Border Protection Command is all very interesting, but it's a bit different from both the US and the Japanese Coast Guards forces. And that raises some interesting questions. They have they basically do different things, and their relationships with their respective navies are a bit different and so on. Having said that, I have noticed just in the last few weeks that the US Coast Guard is thinking seriously about doing more in the Western Pacific with Coast Guard vessels. It's worth looking at. I think, though, the broader question, which let me just drag something across the table, which we haven't even touched on, because I didn't have time anyway in my presentation. You would have noticed that there were 8 categories, I think, of possible action, and I really only addressed one of them properly, and even that, was only superficial. I'd suggest to you some of the biggest challenges will be when we get serious about how do we combine information ops? How do we have proper information ops coordination between our 3 countries and other allies and friends? Because it's going to have to be. I mean, even if you want to count it in terms of the counter-ISIL campaign, that is difficult to do, extremely difficult to do. And it's not, frankly, I don't believe we're really doing that well yet. Well, then you get to, there's a whole lot of other things. What about there are some economic issues and financial measures that are possible to contemplate? Who in our respective countries thinks about coordinating the security aspects of some of those things together? So the point I'm making here is I think it's going to be, you're putting your finger on something which is a broader, actually I think Australia may be slightly better placed in terms of the civil maritime thing than perhaps some other countries, but there's a broader problem. And it's a much bigger one for effective strategy. And that is the non-military, non-diplomatic elements of potential instruments. How do we best coordinate those in our national security systems? I don't think we've done that well for a long, long time. And there are some people in the US that are looking hard about what was done in the Cold War. And do we have to rebuild some of those in a sort of 21st century version? Interesting, I don't know. It's interesting to think about, but you've put your finger on a broader issue. So I haven't really addressed, I think there's scope for civil maritime people to talk more and maybe do stuff together and help some of the regionals in that space. But I think it's a bigger set of issues there. On the Michael Shoebridge's point about a joint planning group, how do we, what could we do? I think my suggestion is there, we could actually have a joint planning group that to start with for a particular exercise or maybe a series of exercises to start. Abbott claim, this is a bit of a Trumpism. I mean, a lot of people don't, those who haven't read Trump's books don't probably understand. It's a bit like saying why isn't he a foreign policy expert? Well, he's never had that training. He's actually someone else quite different. Well, how is he behaving? He's behaving as a negotiating businessman. That's how he's behaving. And so his first step in almost every step is to, in every negotiation, is to ambit claim. So I was putting in an ambit claim, a bit of Trumpism if you like, for having a standing group. I think a good way to start would be on a particular fairly non-challenging exercise, or maybe a series of exercises. Maybe a group that could be stood up but got to know each other well and did things when required. That would be a really good start. Would that be controversial? I don't think it'd be controversial here. I'm not sure whether it'd be controversial in Tokyo. It's a question of making the case, seeing the logic. If you want to have a good exercise, you could argue we need these people to get to know each other and do it well. I would have thought, I don't think our ministers would probably have a big trouble with that. My gut feeling, I may be wrong. I guess the other point I'd make about this is some of these proposals and you know, how to get things moving, a lot of it comes back to national leadership. And James made a really terrific point and emphasised this morning, and he's absolutely right. All of these countries at the moment driven primarily by domestic priorities, and intensely so. And when they're looking, unless there's a crisis, their dwell time in looking at most international stuff is fairly limited. And to be frank also, we're facing a generational thing where many of these people haven't really have to wrestle with, especially international security issues. If you go back a few years, we had people who'd fought in the Vietnam War who were in cabinet, and we had people who'd been in Korea and even, you know, in earlier times, of course, in the Second World War, and they didn't need a lot of convincing. Well, it's a bit different, and I think it's probably you're seeing that reflected in all three countries in various ways, although, so it's not going to be simple, but I think I like the idea, I come back to the point of transparency. If you put the facts in front of people very clearly, and if you show them the pictures, and you point out some of the consequences, I think it can be a pretty riveting story about things need to be done. I think the other thing, though, is in many of those areas, including the ones that I listed, we've already doing a lot, but we're just talking about reshaping and doing things a bit differently and maybe more intensely in certain areas.
Thank you very much. And Japanese potential for leadership role in the region, from a traditionally military point of view, definitely the short answer is no. Japanese military power is quite limited, and Chinese military budget is 4 or 5 times bigger than Japanese defense budget. And also, Japan doesn't have expeditionary forces. Japan has no forward deployment. So the nature of Japanese military power is totally different from other powers, such as the United States or China. So in a sense, Japan cannot replace any American role which the United States has been playing in the region. But from a slightly different point of view, it can be so, because to do that, maybe there should be 2 conditions. One condition is political will, and the second condition is the relevancy of Japanese power. The first one is that Prime Minister Abe, I think, is willing to play a much larger role in the region to enhance rule-based international order in the region. So he has will, and I think that he has a broad political support among Japanese public. About the nature of Japanese power, I don't know how relevant it is. I will soon publish a book both in Japanese and English together with Yoichi Funabashi, a very famous journalist. And I co-authored a chapter on the Global Civilian Power 2.0. And we need to combine 2 things, both civilian power and military power, to play a larger role in the region. And to do that, I point out several examples. One is ODA. 2 years before, Japanese government changed its ODA policy to include some of the security aspects to bring peace and stability by using Japanese ODA. It was prohibited, but now it is possible. This is one thing. The other thing is a joint Coast Guard, as the second question actually means. Japanese government has been helping other Asian countries to build up Coast Guards. And there are many Asian countries who actually were helped by Japanese government to build their own Coast Guards. So they can now, to some extent, defend their own domain by by themselves by having such coast guards, of course, to a limited extent. But coast guards can be useful to avoid war and military clash. So that's why Japanese government is intentionally trying to use coast guard to bring stability and to avoid any unexpected war. So this is a coast guard. The third one is so capacity building is a second Japanese method. And also, Japanese government is helping other Asian countries to educate some expert and official about law. I mean, many Japanese law professors actually go to Asian country to help their government to have much more sophisticated legal system. So by having their own legal system, they can understand what the rule of law means or how the rule of law is important, not just in their own countries, but in regional order as well. So Japanese approach is quite indirect. Non-combating, it's quite civilian-oriented approach. But Prime Minister Abe has been, of course, increasing some of the Japanese security activities or security cooperation with other countries. That's why Japanese current strategy is different from previous strategy by combining both civilian and military areas. But that approach is quite different from American approach or Chinese approach. So I don't know how relevant it is. If it's not relevant, Japan cannot become a leadership role, can become a leader in that region or can play some leadership role. But if it is relevant, to the extent it is relevant, I think that Japan can enlarge its role in the region.
Just a very quick one, if I may, to the panel. How serious are we about trilateral cooperation when we can't agree on a bilateral reciprocal access agreement with Japan after years of negotiation? Ross's ideas of standing up a strategic planning group and other initiatives like that seem to me very much dependent on being able to operate within each other's countries. But it all seems to rest on these endless debates about privileges and immunities while the world has changed in the meantime.
Thank you. My name is Miles Cooper, formerly with the Department of Foreign Affairs and Trade, and now a visiting fellow at the ANU's Coral Bell School. There's been a lot of discussion about, a lot of very constructive discussion about ways of enhancing the Australia-Japan-US strategic partnership, and that's all very desirable and commendable. But there's also been the suggestion that the United States might take a step back from underpinning security in East Asia, and suggestions that the new administration might place demands upon Japan, which for various reasons Japan would find it very hard to meet in the security sphere. And I guess one could go on from that and suggest that that could affect the state and the health of the alliance. My question is, given that Japan is really in quite a vulnerable position in quite a dangerous neighbourhood, can you envisage any circumstances in which the Japanese government might be tempted to consider acquiring a nuclear weapons capability?
John Blexon.
Yeah, John Blexon from the Strategic and Defence Study Centre. Look, I really enjoyed the presentations. The question that kind of came out of it in my mind was, I wonder how this is going to be perceived in Beijing, and does it matter? And if it does, what should we do about it? And how much should we let that thinking influence our choices on what we do? And I'd be interested in the panel's views on that. Thanks.
Thank you, everyone. My name's Cameron Noble from the Department of Foreign Affairs and Trade. I mean, everyone, and this follows on a bit from Bill's question, but everyone has talked about the need to do more, including our esteemed Japanese speakers. But the fact is that there's still a lot of opposition in Japan to, whether it be the public, the bureaucracy, or political circles, about Japan doing more, especially in terms of military activities. A lot of people don't see the greater value of doing more cooperation. Public opinion has changed slightly with China's growing assertiveness, but it's still a very slow process. So I'm just wondering, I was hoping to get the opinion of Dr. Hosoya about how he thinks Japan is changing its attitudes, both in all of those three circles. Thank you.
Should we maybe reverse the order this time, and Professor Hosoya, would you like to start off, and particularly in response to that last question?
Yes, difficult questions, but important ones. The last one, Japan should do more, in particular in military field, and also the previous nuclear weapons. In Japan's national security strategy of 2013, it was written, it is included that Japan should respect three principles on nuclear, non-nuclear. And maybe within a few years, Japanese government will produce the new one, new national security strategy. The point is whether the government or the government panel will include still the three principles on non-nuclear, because more and more countries in the region are having nuclear weapons. And among Japanese officials and also among Japanese public opinion, it's quite a small minority who advocate that Japan should have nuclear weapons, because we need to, together with nuclear weapons, we need to have ballistic missiles or maybe nuclear submarines to maintain a second strike capabilities. Or Japan is a small island, so it's very difficult to hide those nuclear weapons or missiles. So from perhaps a operational and strategic point of view, maybe it's difficult for Japan to fully exploit or fully utilize the advantages of nuclear weapons. So I personally think that Japan shouldn't and cannot have it. But maybe Japanese debates about nuclear weapon is more motivated and initiated by Japanese nationalistic feeling to have it, because North Korea have it, and now some of the experts in South Korea are starting to debate about that, on the importance of the possibility of ROK to have it. And some other Asian countries are interested in it. And if all other Asian countries have nuclear weapons, I don't think that the Japanese people deny the possibility of having our own. But until then, I mean, until a foreseeable future, I think that the Japanese people and the voters and the government officials, political leaders, do not really have a strong will to have it, I mean, Japanese own nuclear weapons. And the last question about Japan should do more about military field. This is a very important question, because as I talked previously, that now there exist much less legal constraints. Beforehand, there existed many, many legal constraints to do some military activities. But now, because there are less military, legal constraints, now, it is political will whether Japan should spend more money or to do more military activities to contribute to international society. And I don't know whether the current Prime Minister, Prime Minister Abe, has a strong will to expand military activities. So far, I don't see it, because Prime Minister and the Chief Cabinet Secretary Suga clearly deny Japanese operation, ISR operation in South China Sea, because it is dangerous and costly. We don't have sufficient ships. We use most of the ships in East China Sea. And it's difficult to move our ships from East China Sea to South China Sea. And it is dangerous because we don't have, between Japan and China, any maritime communication mechanism so far. If we have, between the United States and China, they have it, but we don't have it. So it means that any unexpected clash will be regional war. So I don't think that the Japanese government is willing to undertake a much broader security military activities except for our own national defense.
Just briefly, really interesting question about status of forces agreements and the like and the difficulties of negotiating. I'm probably have the unusual background of having actually have to draft a couple of status of forces agreement early in my career, and it's my enduring memory of it is the complexity and the need to tailor for specific circumstances some key issues. I'm not familiar at all, and I'm not really going to comment on the current negotiations or as what's been, because I'm simply not familiar with what actually has been the stumbling blocks in this particular case or these cases. But I'd simply say this: there have been cases in the past that I am aware of where it has been necessary to elevate to surprisingly high levels to clear away some obstacles or get some clear understanding, maybe even write some new words, because a lot of state of forces agreements are, and this is I learnt early in the piece, use essentially the same words for between different countries or very similar, and sometimes people get locked into positions which might need someone senior to shove them a little bit sideways in the better interest. But I don't know in this case. Just this, John Blaxman made this really interesting point. Well, what should we worry about what Beijing thinks or does it matter? I guess the basic point is, I think I agree with James and a couple of other people this morning. I think we've been a little bit too timid on some aspects. I'm not saying we should be, if we're going to have effective deterrence amongst close Western allies, we have to make it very clear that we have certain positions and we're prepared to do things about protecting those interests. And that's part of deterrence. That's the very foundational element. There have been times in recent years, I'd argue, that where we haven't done that very well. And I think it's also not inappropriate amongst major allies, particularly there are some countries that can do more than others, the United States in particular can, sometimes leaving a bit of ambiguity and uncertainty in a competitor's mind. So they're rather more cautious than they otherwise might be. Now, this has got to be done very carefully and with a lot of careful thought. But the point I'd make is sometimes we are a little bit too cautious about saying anything or hardly anything for fear that you might get a bad press report in the Beijing Daily. Well, I frankly think we ought to be a little bit more grown up than that. But we also ought to be very careful. Not for me.
Okay, just a few comments. The first one about the how can you make progress in all of this? It is true that sometimes when you negotiate with the Japanese about certain things, you'd think you were negotiating with the North Koreans. I've told actually the environmental people in Australia are the equivalent when you try to bring equipment in. But nonetheless, you find where you can make progress. You have these just paradoxical conundrums that it really seems like you're dealing with an enemy. And yet you are able to make progress. And I would cite the amphibious progress the Japanese have made in the last 3 years, which a guy who went to sleep 5 years ago woke up today and saw what the Japanese have, what they have done with it, wouldn't believe that it happened. And it's progress that has been made whilst all these other, the SOFA agreements, the Okinawa promises never get kept. But very considerable progress in this area. So you find where you can make progress, and things do move forward. Regarding what are the Japanese capable of? Speaking like a guy from Virginia, but I did live in Japan 20 years, and they're capable of doing anything they want to do. Article 9 of the Constitution is a wonderful excuse for not doing anything Japan doesn't feel like doing. And I'm not being I'm saying it in a funny way, but I'm serious. There's a sort of a mindset that manifested itself before the Gulf War. And guys from around Koizumi were asking me, which mean they'd really scraped to the bottom of the barrel in Tokyo, what is the least we have to do so George Bush will not be mad at us? At which time I, of course, took offense at that. But that was their thinking. What's the least we have to do, rather than what can we do to be helpful? So I would say one underestimates what Japan is capable of at their own peril. They can do whatever they want, to my way of thinking. The last one about worrying about what Beijing thinks. I wouldn't say don't worry about it, but it is possible to tie yourself into such a knot you are incapable of moving because you're concerned about what will China think. I would suggest that we've gotten ourselves into this fix in the South China Sea where China's pretty much has almost got de facto control of it, or at least a hair's breadth away, because we were so concerned about what China would think. But I think it is, and in as Ross has said, that in foreign affairs, business as well, if the other side knows you are not automatically going to concede, that's a helpful thing to have. You want some uncertainty in that. But we have spotted China a lot of runs by that approach, and we'll see what happens when it looks as though the new administration might actually take a different approach that isn't so concerned about what China thinks. It'd be good to make the Chinese wonder what the Americans think for once. So we'll see how that goes.